Could you grab a chair? So, Susan's going to help animals that are hurt and can't return to the wild.
Yes.
And remain strangers.
But, everything's a food chain, right? And if they remove animals from the food chain, then what will happen to the food chain?
The chain is still standing. There's still millions and millions of animals out in the wild.
There were just two white rhinos left, and they just made a baby.
Zoos also help breed animals. They take pandas. If they help breed them, and then they release them into the wild to help the food chain still stand up.
Ryan's obsession here, man.
Look, some of the narratives died.
Can you help? No, that's not gonna happen.
Number one.
When you spray the cone on logs aggressively.
No, you're right.
This is what clean you want.
Can you help? So number four.
Look.
They're both as opposed to
Yeah.
So we could kind of...
Ladies and gentlemen, today's resolution is, should animals be kept in zoos or in the wild? The purpose of this debate is to look at both sides of this topic from varying points of view. For the affirmative or proposition side, which agrees with today's resolution that animals should be kept in zoos, we have the blue team. For the negative or opposition side, which disagrees with the resolution of the red team, we will begin with an opening statement by the proposition side first. This will be followed by an opening statement by the opposition side.
I'm representing the argument of the proposition side that animals should be kept in zoos. Did you know that zoos can breed animals that are endangered and save species? In a text called Are Zoos Good or Bad, I found that after 10 years of working to strengthen the population of an endangered California condor, a type of vulture, the Los Angeles and San Diego Zoo were able to rebuild the population using only two dozen birds to around 170 birds. A successful breeding program brought the Pierre David's deer back from extinction. Also, in another text called How to Save a Hippo, it said that a baby hippo named Fiona was born 6 weeks early. Baby hippo was little and weak. A zoo keeper nursed the baby hippo. The zoo took care of it. If the baby hippo was born in the wild, it would have died. But the zoo saved it, and they released it into the wild. Does this convince you that animals should be kept in zoos?
I'm presenting the argument animals don't belong in zoos. For example, tigers live in Asia. Some tigers live in rainforests. Zoos are not at all like rainforests, tigers. Even for cheetahs, zoos aren't like savannas. Cheetahs like to run 110 kilometers per hour. In zoos, cheetahs can't do that. Lions live in groups called prides. In zoos, most animals live alone. One important fact from PETA Kids to consider is that many zoos claim that the reason why they exist and continue to breed animals is to help protect endangered species. But that's not true. In fact, most animals in zoos are endangered, and those who will likely never be released into their natural habitat. Penguins live in Antarctica. Zoos can't get as cold as that. Even if zoos do get to that high temperature, still it will be too cold for the people. When you come to think of it, zoos are just prisons that leave animals with no ways to defend themselves or escape dangerous situations. Animals in zoos all over the U.S. have been imprisoned, been starved, and even burned in fires. Even the zookeepers during natural disasters are unable to help the animals. For example, after Hurricane Katrina, most of the 10,000 aquatic animals in New Orleans died after the power failed and employees were forced to leave. Other animals have died after feeding trash that was thrown into their cages, and some animals have been beaten or killed by people who stole them from their pens or cages. I hope that by listening to my article that I have started to inform you, animals don't belong in zoos.
My argument for the proposition side is animals should be kept in zoos. In the text that I'm reading, it says zoos have been entertaining people with exotic animals. At zoos, you can see animals that you've never seen before. Zoos educate people by telling people about endangered animals and their habitats. At some aquariums, they have some animals that do tricks, like seals. Some schools take field trips to zoos, and some zookeepers tell kids about animals. At some zoos, you're allowed to feed some animals. More than 170 million people visit zoos and aquariums a year. That is why I think zoos are entertaining and educating.
My second argument is zoos are not educational because zoos are just trying to persuade you that it is okay to keep animals in cages or enclosures. They are in captivity, bored, cramped, and very far from their natural habitats. People only spend a few minutes at each display and learn very little about the animals they're looking at. Another reason zoos are not educational is because when you read the display, it does not tell you all the facts about that animal because my team and I searched it up on the computer. This is evidence why zoos and conservancies are not educational.
Presenting the argument animals should be enclosed, I found evidence from Clearwater Marine that proved animals have enough space in their enclosures. The Clearwater Marine is planning an extension. They are going to connect 5 pools together. Another example is zoos use natural looking habitats to make the animals feel at home. The zoo workers give the animals toys to play with so they stay active. This is why I think animals should be in zoos.
My argument is that some animals get more attention than others. In the Minnesota zoos, farm exhibit grew up and didn't attract as many visitors. The zoo took them to livestock auctions where many of them ended up being sent to be slaughtered. Moreover, lots of zoos breed animals to make babies and the result make lots of money. When babies grow up through, they aren't as popular. Zoos often trade, loan, or sell adult animals. So, me and my team suggest that animals should not be in zoos.
Mm-hmm. I'll be making the final argument in favor of the resolution, animals should be kept in zoos. Through evidence presented by my team, we will convince you that our argument is the best side to be on. Based on the text, Clearwater Marine Aquarium, Nicholas is a bottlenose dolphin and the only male dolphin currently in the aquarium. He was rescued with his mother as a baby. Based on what I read from the article Scholastic News, today's major zoos have pledged to become protectors, not collectors. The aim is to create new wild populations from old zoos. More than 175 million people each year visit North America to go to aquariums each year. Most importantly, zoos try to save money from the tickets and they go to habitats to make animals feel like home. Winter is a bottlenose dolphin at Clearwater Marine Aquarium. She got her tail stuck in a crab trap. They had to spend a lot of money getting a fake tail. They taught her how to swim and play in it. The article, How to Save a Hippo, says no hippo survives so small. If it was in the wild, it would have not survived. That is why my team thinks that animals should be kept in zoos.
I am presenting the negative team's final argument about zoocosis. Zoocosis is when animals act strangely and even hurt themselves when they get really bored or frustrated. Some animals hurt themselves like monkeys and birds. Giraffes twist their necks and bend their heads back and forth. Also, some elephants bob their heads side to side. This is not what animals usually do in the wild. Animals are locked up in small cages and lots of the animals should have to run a lot of miles, but when they don't get to, they get frustrated. Some animals can get serious injuries by trying to run or doing their usual activities in the zoo. In conclusion, I think animals should be in zoos.
Your argument said that conservancies and zoos don't educate people. Well, I've been to the Naples Zoo, and they do educate the keeper there, so like they have different times for you to go to those animals' cages, and they'll tell you about what they do and like what they eat, and they can talk about endangered animals.
Yeah, but sometimes people don't pay attention to those. Most people actually don't pay attention to those because they're too busy looking at the animals. So like they don't learn a lot.
And I've also been to a conservancy, and they take hurt animals there, and some endangered animals, and they can teach you about them too.
Yeah, well, some of them are endangered, but most of them aren't, so they don't get to live their regular life in the wild.
I have a question for the proposition side, because when animals get sent to the zoos, and if, like, let's say, like, a natural disaster happens, and then all that stuff, like, there could be trash in their cages, and all the other people who were protecting the animals could have left and not do anything about it.
Well, they usually have zookeepers clean their cages every once in a while.
Like I was saying, if there's a natural disaster, and they have nothing to eat, and let's say if they survive, and there's a bunch of water in their cages, and it's so flooded that they just can't get out of the cages and they're trapped in it. And then they would probably drown.
I remember like when Hurricane Irma, I believe, hit, they would take the animals and like put them in these like little cages and take them somewhere else when it was happening.
Yeah, but sometimes they don't take the animals at all because like a natural disaster happens right away and they have no idea it's in the place either.
They have warnings about natural disasters.
So you would take them before they even know it happened. I mean, Irma was just like, it turned at the last minute and hit us, so we had to leave.
Jake, you also said that sometimes, not all of the times.
Well, that means most of the times they do.
Well, sometimes means 50-50.
I have a question for the opposition side. They don't just breed any animals, they actually breed endangered animals and save the species.
Okay. Well, some endangered species are really hard to breed, like some certain animals. Because some animals, they just have one left of its kind and they have no other DNA. Like, for example, I think you have to get DNA from, like, two animals to get, like, one animal.
Well, they usually start breeding before there's only one left. They usually start breeding when there's at least, like, 50 or 100 left. So they have a lot of time.
But
so
then,
they have DNA.
But some animals are left in the wild and nobody cares about them, while humans literally come over and like slaughter them or something.
This is proposition side. They keep talking about how animals are like endangered and stuff, and they usually get endangered from people killing them, not other animals. And when they get hurt and stuff, that's either from people, which is their fault, or other animals, which would be natural. So it's okay.
Actually, so for the opposition side, when someone was done reading, they said there's no zoos in Africa, and that I've seen zoos in Africa, so, and lots of the animals are endangered there from the people going to hunt there, so I think there should be zoos in Africa. You said there's a lot, and yeah, did you do any research about there being no zoos in Africa?
Well, basically I've done some research about elephants and stuff, and usually those zoos in Africa are really small, and usually they don't really let them walk around that much. Oh. Plus, it's burning there.
Oh, lots of times they like take them in like trucks.
So I have a question. I I have something to say to the proposition side. There was a text, and it was five things zoos don't want you to know about. And there was a hurricane, and many animals got injured, and many of them died from the hurricane. And many of the workers left the zoos, and all the animals were suffering.
Well,
what does
what year was that?
That they spend a lot of money trying to put, like, if there was a polar bear, they would put fans and ice and water for it to swim in, and they would put food into it, and it would clean it. So, and you guys are saying that some animal died because of stress. When they give them toys to play with, and they give them food, water, and everything that they need.
We didn't say
So the reason why you're saying that is probably because that's what they did a long time ago. Oh, there was only like three zoos that had groups of animals. Now they have a bunch of groups.
Proposition was talking. They said something about nickel a dolphin and its mom and. They said that they rescued it, but they never said what they rescued it from. And they said that the dolphin was with its mom, so it kind of seemed like the dolphin was perfectly fine.
No, Nico, in rescue means to help the animal when it's hurt. And why is
it that the rescue was from?
Okay. Callan, are you ready? Okay, go ahead.
I have a question for the proposition because when they said they put all of the money towards saving an animal's natural habitat, then why do they keep them in zoos instead of their natural habitat if they're trying to raise money for it?
Some zoo in the habitat where the animal lives, so everything where the animal lives, it's there already.
Okay. I have a question.
We're not taking it saying it's the whole back.
No,
but many different lands and areas of the natural habitat. We're just taking a small share.
Well, maybe it was a small zoo where lots of animals live, like foxes live in a forest. They could build it there and have foxes, squirrels, bears, and everything that lives in the forest, right in the forest.
And also, she also said that they put a lot of money into making a new dolphin tail. Because I didn't remember hearing her say anything about habitats.
Yeah, I did.
Oh, you did? Oh, I didn't hear it, but.
So if there were no zoos, and if the animal was hurt in the wild, most of the time the mother will leave it behind because it won't keep up, like a broken leg, and it will just have to suffer by a tree or anything. So if it had no zoos, what would it do?
Okay.
they would just keep on dying.
Well, in that case, in the rainforest and stuff, that's a natural habitat. And when animals, that's usually just a food chain. Like, for example, every animal is a part of a food chain. Like, in the sea, sharks are the top of the food chain. And when animals usually get hurt, they're usually a food to, like, another animal.
Yeah, but so the zoos will keep it so we can keep the animals going and they won't be distinct.
When the proposition said, because I kind of forgot this, I used to know this. When they take a tiny bit of another habitat, or their habitat, that's what kind of changed my mind, because I forgot about that.
How does that change your mind? What does that do with your thinking?
It changes my mind because it actually compares to the real wild, because it is real wild. And usually, since the habitat is really big, actually, the habitat that they take the share of is really big. So it seems like the zoo or the conservancy would be really big, but it's actually not compared to the habitat. But it is compared to the animals. Mm-hmm. So they have tons of room to run and play, it feels like it's natural and they're just out in the wild.
So you're feeling now that maybe zoos or conservancies sometimes might be okay?
Where I live, we had a large zoo, and animals were totally in small cages. They had problems, all kinds of issues. And over the years, as I've watched the evolution of this zoo, and Alyssa has been to this zoo now, up in Ohio, it is a large, it always has been a large expanse area, but now they have opened it to be where there's very few cages at all. They build habitats for all of the animals, dens, they have a variety, a massive variety of animals that are in more of a natural environment. And I think that's kind of what you're talking about here is in the proposition group, is that zoos can offer a lot. And we talk about education, it's because zoos expose more people to the animals, and those who want to listen can be taught about them, where, of course, there's still always going to be the open and wild, and you're going to have animals out there. But how many of us travel to those open areas? And, you know, in essence, I know some of you have been in Africa, but how many of us over our lifetime go to Africa to really see what it looks like with animals in their natural habitat, or into India, or any of the other areas where you get some of your larger animals? So I think you need both of them, but I have, in my lifetime, seen zoos evolve, and I think as they evolve, they provide a real benefit to society, as well as to the animals, for breeding purposes. You know, it's not all about selling animals, it's about breeding and sharing with other zoos, or lending to other zoos so they can breed. Mm-hmm. And the other piece to that is universities all sponsor a lot of these education research programs. Mm-hmm. So you wouldn't have all these articles if you didn't have the researchers. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Good job.
Good job.
Good job.
Good job.
Good job.
Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job. Good job.